Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Keeping Christmas, 25 Advent Reflections on a Christmas Carol by Allison Pittman. Narrated by Nancy Peterson. Author's Note. Dear listener, Charles Dickens opens his novella, A Christmas Carol, with this. I have endeavored in this ghostly little book to raise the ghost of an idea, which shall not put my readers out of humor with themselves, with each other, with the season, or with me. May it haunt their houses pleasantly, and no one wish to lay it. Their faithful friend and servant, C.D. I humbly offer this same plea. As a reader, scholar, teacher, and writer, I have always had a deep-rooted fascination with this particular work. I've seen nearly every version ever filmed, from the silent movie available on YouTube to the iconic Lifetime adaptation starring the inimitable Susan Lucci. The arc of the story never changes. Ebenezer Scrooge, no matter the actor who hosts the character, comes off as a miserable person, mean, greedy, abrasive, and lonely. There are circumstances as to why he, or she, for example, Tori Spelling, feels that way. And three supernatural beings guide us through the past, the present, and the future. Watch Scrooged, Scrooge, or Scrooge, with an exclamation point. They all have it. As does A Christmas Carol, A Carol Christmas, or An American Christmas Carol. Scrooge has been embodied by a former Miss America, Vanessa Williams, and a former Fonzie, Henry Winkler. The tale has been animated by pen and ink, augmented by CGI, and cast with Muppets, in which a birdish gonzo plays the role of Dickens himself. No matter what liberties are taken with the story, a dance number in hell, two Marley brothers to capture a Bob Marley moment, the end is the same. All of the Scrooges confront their sins, repent, and go on to live kinder, more generous lives. It takes a reading of the original text, however, to capture the true spiritual essence of Scrooge's transformation. A close, very close, reading reveals his visits to be more than simple encounters with supernatural beings. They are confrontations with Christ, the one in whose name we celebrate this season. Scrooge doesn't just become a better man. He becomes a new man. So, just as Scrooge relies on the spirits to guide him on this pilgrimage of self-awareness, I beg the opportunity to offer myself to guide you through the text of this beloved Christmas classic. Maybe, like me, you've read the original a dozen times and will, again like me, see something in a new light. Perhaps you've watched some film adaptation every Christmas of your life, but you haven't delved into the text. If that's the case, I invite you to grab a copy to read for yourself. I promise the dense prose that may have seemed intimidating in the past will come to life. It did for me, in the same paragraphs and pages I thought I knew by heart. The difference being, I gave the story over to my heart, looking past Scrooge's obvious outside transformation to find the profound inner change that brings it about. He is not, with all compliments to Dr. Seuss's Grinch, a creature whose heart merely grows. He is a man whose heart is transplanted. Full disclosure, I'm not a theologian or any kind of Dickensian scholar. I'm an English teacher who has devoted a lifetime to helping students wrangle with symbolism and metaphor. And I'm a writer who strives to bring fictitious souls to Christ within every work. For us, as we travel this little book together, I hope to bring the best of both my worlds. To enlighten, to lead, and to share bits and pieces of my own story. Throughout my study for this work, I clung to the promise found in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 17 through 19. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone, the new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. I see Dickens's tale as a message of reconciliation, as well as an illustration of the life we ought to live once reconciled to Christ. It's not only a journey through the past, present, and future, but also a journey from death to life. Not just a reclamation, but a rebirth. The season of Advent is itself a journey. 24 days to mark the moment when Jesus Christ came to transform the world. But it is so much more than just a Christmas countdown. It's a time when we can celebrate our own transformational experience. The long winter nights of Advent are meant to be a time of contemplation, reflection, anticipation. The story of Scrooge happens over the course of one of those nights, a matter of hours, a time of confrontation, repentance, and salvation. And so, to paraphrase, I have endeavored with this little book to raise up the eternal truths which shall not raise the ire of Dickensian scholars, theologians, Christmas fanatics, or classic film buffs. May it haunt your hearts pleasantly. A faithful friend and servant of Christ, A.P. 1. Dead to begin with. Marley was dead to begin with. There is no doubt whatever about that. These days, with the Christmas season so full of white twinkle lights and red silk ribbons adorning unnaturally green trees, it's hard to reconcile such a bleak, grave statement with the story so synonymous with the holiday. The register of his burial was signed by the clergyman, the clerk, the undertaker, and the chief mourner. In other words, he was dead, 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 dead. Old Marley was as dead as a doornail. Marley was so dead. How dead was he? Deader than a coffin nail. Deader than a 2-a-penny nail. Dead enough to earn the phrase that we all still use to drive a point home like a hammer on a nail head. Not deader than a doornail, mind you, because once you're a doornail, well, you aren't going to get much deader. But dead, gone, undertaken and buried. Merry Christmas. God begins his Christmas story in much the same way. But, thousands of Sunday school teachers and nativity scene collectors and pseudo-secular celebrators decry, Christmas is the infant holy, away in the manger, the silent night, holy night, where unto us a child is born. Pregnant Mary, stalwart Joseph, infant Jesus, cattle lowing, donkeys looking on, sheep following shepherds, following a star. Christmas is life. All true. But the life of Christmas, like all life as it cycles through God's creations, begins with death. We cannot sing, O little town of Bethlehem, without also pondering the lyrics of Mary, Did You Know? Yes, we know the sweet story of the swaddled child. But we also know the story of that same child, grown and crucified. We know those chubby hands will be pierced. The downy head will someday wear a crown of thorns. The shepherds left their fields to behold a perfect lamb born for slaughter. Quite the sobering shadow on your nativity scene. The timeline of the scriptures holds a sharp divide. Old Testament. New Testament. The opening chapters of the Gospels are resplendent with life, with beginnings, John takes us to the birth of the universe, where there was nothing but the Word. Mark promises to tell a story about the good news. Luke sets out to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus. Matthew starts with the family tree, a record of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Any of these texts would be perfect for the voiceover narration in the church Christmas program, especially John, if you want to add certain gravitas to the shepherds in the field. All those elements of the nativity are so achingly familiar. It's easy to forget what came just before. The nothingness. The silence. Before that, in the waning verses of the last of the Old Testament prophets, Malachi speaks a dire warning. Surely the day is coming, it will burn like a furnace. All the arrogant and every evildoer will be stubble, and the day that is coming will set them on fire, says the Lord Almighty. Malachi chapter 4, verse 1. And after that, silence. Malachi dies, and the tongues of God's prophets fall still for 400 years. Nothing spoken to the clergyman, nothing recorded by the clerks. Mute, like a doornail. That's not to say that God didn't speak during that time. I'm sure he communicated as he always has, whispering directly to the hearts of righteous people, clearing paths so the wise might follow. Gentle rebukes of conscience in the face of sin. Still, 4 centuries go by without anything to pass the muster of recorded scripture. Nothing for the masses. No encouragement, no warnings. Prophecy nailed shut until the time was right to wrench it open and start a new testament for humankind. Too many film adaptations of A Christmas Carol skip over the death of Marley. They like to open with the snow-strewn Victorian Avenue, carolers plowing through the third verse of Good King Wenceslas, men tipping top hats, delicacies displayed in candle-lit windows, a bookshop, sweet shop, tailors and haberdashers. The Hallmark Entertainment production, from the days when Hallmark took their Christmas programming a little more seriously, starring Patrick Stewart, however, opens with a black horse-drawn hearse. Marley's casket in a grave surrounded by snow-cold ground. Scriptures about life being fleeting, like a flower, sown in misery. Later, the sound of a scratching quill, the book signed to certify Marley's eternal state. Melodramatic? Yes. Perfectly so. Marley was dead. Later, readers learn he's been dead 7 years. A perfected number of years, to be exact. He died on the eve of Christmas. He's been dead long enough for the forces of nature to erase his name from the sign hanging outside of his place of business. Dickens implies this same time of silence, for the story picks up with the single living soul who stood as chief mourner at the officiation of Marley's death. The reader must be completely, fully accepting that the time of Marley is over, that his voice is removed from all natural sound. Marley is dead. Scrooge, on the other hand, is very much alive. Well, mostly. 2. Covetous old sinner. Ebenezer Scrooge. Like all of Charles Dickens's most memorable characters, the pronouncing of his name brings the speaker's lips into a mirthful twist. It is a combination of ancient, established weight and authorial whimsy. Ebenezer, meaning stone of help, references a stone placed by the prophet Samuel after God saved the Israelites from being destroyed by the Philistines. 1 Samuel chapter 7, verses 10 through 12. And Scrooge, a name that, according to the film The Man Who Invented Christmas, Dickens came up with after a night of pacing the floor, making noises to himself. the two names come together to create this man who, perhaps unlike any other fictional character ever penned, is simultaneously hated and pitied. We the readers root for Scrooge as much as we despise him. He is a villain without any real enemy, an anti-hero with no cause beyond himself. And when he first appears upon the page, he is, like his best and only true friend, Jacob Marley, dead. Or he may as well be. Sometimes people new to the business called Scrooge Scrooge, and sometimes Marley, but he answered to both names. It was all the same to him. Scrooge has not, of course, achieved doornail status. Outwardly, he is very much alive, as filmmakers tend to portray him as a man full of vitality, storming through the Victorian streets, his walking stick attacking the ice at each step. His voice, when he bursts into his office, is booming and strident, although the novel describes it as shrewd and grating. He is a man of vigor. Death itself, of any natural cause, seems a possibility as distant as spring, and anybody who wishes his demise faces decades of disappointment. Dickens captures this paradox in his introduction of the tight-fisted, hand-at-the-grindstone Scrooge. First, there are the verbs. A squeezing, wrenching, grasping, scraping, clutching, covetous old sinner. His actions may not be admirable, but he is active. And if Ebenezer denotes a man of stone, such is Scrooge, hard and sharp as flint, from which no steel had ever struck out generous fire. There is a lifeless chill to the man as well. A frosty rime was on his head, and on his eyebrows, and his wiry chin. Now, having a head of white hair and a white beard doesn't automatically carry a feeling of death. Other icons of the Christmas season, you know who you are, might fit the same description. But Scrooge emits no jolly holiday spirit. In fact, quite the opposite. He carried his own low temperature always about with him. He iced his office in the dog days and didn't thaw it 1 degree at Christmas. All of this puts him in the perfect place for transformation. Death to life. Where Dickens points out that Scrooge is a covetous old sinner, the Apostle Paul makes it a point to say that we are all as such. You were dead in your transgressions and sins. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1. He goes on to say, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. Verses 4 through 5. Scrooge squeezes and wrenches and grasps, even as he's blue-lipped and dead. Beggars avoid him. Children fear him. Even the blind men's dogs would tug their owners into doorways and up courts. And the kicker? That's exactly how Scrooge liked it, evidence of just how powerful his transformation will be. His story begins at the peak of his season of Advent, only he hasn't been preparing himself. He's been prepared. He's like that perfect Christmas cookie, crisped around the edges but soft in the middle. He just doesn't know about his own softness. External heat and cold had little influence on Scrooge. No warmth could warm, no wintry weather chill him. In other words, he was impervious to the influences of the world. He is poised between heartbeats. He'll either have another, life, or he won't, death. Ultimately, that choice will be his. But the opportunity to make that choice comes to Scrooge in the same way it comes to all of us. We'll see, over the course of this story, that Scrooge does nothing good. As far as we know, he never has done anything good. Chances are, if not for the supernatural intervention in his path, he never will do anything.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.